This is another episode where I talk with the representative of the political party to inform you, my dear listeners, outdoors people, what political options are the best, really, for activities you do. Because that's how democracy works and how the podcast works, is that I want you to get informed. So again, the disclaimer is I'm not trying to convince anyone for one or other political option, and rather I just try to ask questions that are relevant for outdoors people, get the answers, and let you to decide. So our guest today is Pippa Hackett from Green Party. She's a Green Party councillor, and she's also a spokesperson on agriculture, food, forestry, heritage, and animal welfare. So probably the perfect person to talk about Green Party and Green Party's approach and plans with relation to various issues that are affecting outdoors activities. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Pippa Hackett. Pippa Hackett, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you for doing this. It's great. It's a second podcast of the series, I hope, when we can talk about how political decisions are affecting outdoors people and what they love and what they do. Mm-hmm. It's been great success in the recent elections for Green Party.
Absolutely, yeah. It's been unprecedented, really. I mean, we heard about this green wave, you know, mm-hmm. sweeping, I suppose, throughout Europe, you know, for mm-hmm. the last number of months. And it certainly swept over Ireland this, you know, this last since in the European and local elections.
Can you describe the size of that success and like how big that is compared to what was happening before?
Well, I suppose in Ireland, in a local sense, we have quadrupled our numbers of local councillors. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, quite a sizable, you know, increase for our own party. We've also got two European members elected, mm-hmm. which is, you know, out of three, we only ran three, and to get two in is just really wow. fantastic, you know. And I think it really sends out a message from the people of Ireland that, you know, they are embracing sort of a greener way of thinking and maybe a greener way of living, and I think it's very positive.
Yeah, and you've been elected yourself.
Yes, I got.
Is it like a first time?
Yeah, it was my first time to run. I ran in County Offaly in the local area, was the Edenderry local area. I took the last seat. It was fairly nail biting stuff towards the end, but you know, I'm in now, and a lot of people are really surprised that, you know, somebody from the Green Party could ever get elected in Offaly, so it's great.
Does it feel weird?
It's still a little weird, still a little bit fresh. You know, I'm quite au fait generally with, mm-hmm. you know, politics and the mm-hmm. political, you know, realm in Ireland. Yeah. Local politics is a little bit different. I was probably more aware of how the national politics works, just because we had, you know, I was involved with the TDs we have, and I've been the spokesperson on agriculture and food and forestry and heritage and animal welfare.
There's all the things I want to touch on today.
Yeah, so you know, very much, I suppose, from a rural perspective, it was great to get elected. Yeah.
It's great. And you're outdoors person yourself.
Yeah, well,
what are the pursuits? How are you enjoying them?
Well, I suppose mainly at the moment I run. Mm-hmm. I run competitively as well as for, wow. you know, clearing my head mm-hmm. and just getting out there. Outdoorsy otherwise. I mean, I used to do a little bit of cycling, but the running really took over. I found that.
Is it because like it's more accessible? You don't have to put all the things around you.
Yeah, I think it was more accessible. I could do it with my kids mm-hmm. in a safer way as well. Actually, every time I went out on my bike, I actually expected to die. It was terrifying. I live in rural Ireland. We have small, narrow mm-hmm. roads, and even if you go onto the main roads, it's terrifying. I've a lot of respect for cyclists. It's not easy out there.
It can be a problem, you know. I think that Ireland is fairly, like, Irish drivers are fairly civilized and friendly, here I say it. Not saying that this is like all rosy, but, you know, compared to different parts of Europe, it's quite good. But yeah, the narrow roads can be dangerous.
Yeah, I don't think our roads are really designed terribly well for any outdoor pursuit, whether it's running, but cycling in particular. I think, you know, some of those, even the, if you get passed by a lorry, you know, traveling at 100 kilometers an hour, you feel the drag. It's terrifying.
I know.
So running, at least you can jump into the verge or dive into the hedge. You can't really do that on a bike.
Well, yeah, if you have to, I suppose. Okay, I think it's a good moment and like a good pivot now into that particular issue. Is there anything that Green Party or you in particular have any initiatives that could help that situation with cycling and promotion of cycling and like a cycling routes and anything like that? Is that something that is high on the agenda, or is it somewhere in the agenda, or like how?
It would be pretty high on Green Party agenda, particularly in urban settings. You know, if we can get more people, you know, cycling and on bikes, that means hopefully there's less people in cars. So from a perspective of emissions alone, carbon emissions, you'd be lowering that. Also then there's the sort of health benefits, and especially if children can get involved, kids can cycle to school rather than parents driving them. That's a hugely benefit to not only the environment but just their lives. I would like to think even outside of urban areas, you might have any, you know, planning in, you know, new road designs, say around rural towns, for example, you could have that they would factor in maybe cycle lanes, walking paths along with it. I mean, I drove around Kilkenny city there, you know, I go around it fairly frequently, but, you know, even the ring road around it, they factored in a cycle lane and a walking, you know, running path, if you like. So it's segregated from the road, and yet you're sort of out in the outskirts of the city and you've got this space. Whereas if you look at, I know Tullamore, quite a big town near close to me, it has a ring road also, but there's no such facility or no such, that wasn't factored in. So, you know, perhaps down the line, or, you know, had there been more of a green voice on the council when that decision was made, if there was a planning, you know, aspect to it, you know, that might have happened.
Do you feel like other political parties kind of getting into the area traditionally reserved for Green Party, because it's like, you know, it's a green wave and everyone thinks green, so now everybody starts talking about the things that I would imagine that you guys were talking about for a long time? Does it feel like, whoa, what's going on now? This is kind of our...
I mean, in one sense it should be welcomed, because it would be great if you know, if the broader political spectrum or sphere would you know, engage in more green views and green thinking. There is a sort of certain skepticism there that it's just words, you know, it's a green wash of sorts, and it looks good and it sounds cool to say you're green and you're all about recycling and all of these things. But if you don't actually follow that up with some sort of active policies in the area, especially from government parties, you sort of have to sort of think, well, do you really, are you really green, you know? So I think, you know, if it were very proactive, if they were, you know, about their views, then I think that would be welcomed. I don't feel like we're like jealous or they're stealing our clothes as such, but, you know, if they're going to use the green angle and sell the green message and not actually live up to it, then I think that's the problem.
That's a good point. That on the one end it's good, it's like, hey, you welcome, but on the other hand, you have like a better credentials, like we've been talking about this for so long.
Absolutely,
like,
yeah.
So,
yeah.
Hey.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I think it's, you know, even in Ireland, the Green Party was founded in 1981. I actually happen to live next door to the founder of the Green Party.
Oh,
yeah,
lovely.
So it's Christopher Fettes. He's 82, I think, if I give him his right age. So he's, you know, even back then, the issues you know, that he felt were important, and that's why, you know, he formed the party are mm-hmm. still very much here, you know, 30 yes. odd, 40 years later nearly, you know, and that's yeah. sort of frightening in one sense, but maybe mm. maybe change is happening.
Are those years like a more, you know, they're more severe?
Oh, they must be, yeah, definitely. I think, and I think we're definitely more aware, you know, he was probably before his time in Ireland, mm-hmm. maybe, you know, mm-hmm. about, you know, green issues and environmental yes. issues, where now it's really in our
it's
face.
It's usually that the founders of certain movements and things are kind of ahead of their time. They kind yeah. of see things coming.
Yes.
And they're starting at the head, and then other people kind of say, oh, this is was it, yeah. let's do something about mm-hmm. it, and then there is already movement, organization and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. I think, and I think that's very much a green sort of thing mm-hmm. as well. We look to the future and quite far into it, you know. We're not just sort of election cycles or, you know, 4 years time. We're looking at 10 that's 15 and 20 years time, and that's hard to sell, you know. That's a hard yes. sort of sell sometimes to people who are maybe just worried about their jobs or mm-hmm. their homes or their mortgage payments, or you know, mm-hmm. it's a hard one, but it's vital, really.
I think that's one of the things that is perhaps the advantage of the Green Party, that so clearly defined agenda and focus.
Yes, and I think that's one of the things we've been credited with of late, that we've not drifted away from our mm-hmm. original sort of fundamental ideas and, you know, philosophies, and yeah. that has stood to us. It's yeah. you know, we've sunk because of it in mm-hmm. times gone by, and now mm-hmm. it's, you know, it's coming to the fore
sticking
again.
To
so we're sticking, yeah, we are sticking to our guns because okay. we think it's important.
There's obviously, we're going to touch on a lot of subjects today on the podcast, but there's a one thing in particular that I want to get out of the way at the very beginning. As a part of the podcast, I'm talking a lot about how people need to cooperate to protect the nature, to protect the outdoors, to protect the wildlife, how they need to work together rather than bash heads and so on and so forth. And I found there is a lot of unease, particularly in the hunting and angling community, towards Green Party, which I think is kind of like a fundamental issue. Because on one hand, hunters and anglers should be, or are, or should be, natural allies for protecting of the environment, protecting of the habitat, having a lot of wild animals and, you know, healthy rivers, salmon runs, deer in the woods, you mm-hmm. know, wolves, bear, what have you. On one hand, that they're like natural allies. On the other hand, they're kind of not so sure about whether Green Party is a good option for them, because also Green Party tends to attract a lot of people who are, you know, labeled as animal lovers, mm-hmm. you know, stop all the shooting, stop all the angling, don't do this, don't do that, and so on. And I think it would be a major loss if Green Party couldn't tap out to the potential of those people. So could you tell me what's a position of Green Party on especially hunting and angling community, and how they are perceived as a stakeholders in the outdoors and in nature and so mm-hmm. on?
No, it's a good question. It's as you say, it could be sort of perceived as sort of divisive in a way, but I think mm-hmm. it's I think if you look at the Green Party policy in terms of sort of animal welfare, we don't actually, you know, pinpoint out hunters or anglers at all. You know, we were more about the welfare of any particular animal, and if any sort of situation causes undue distress or pain or fear or any mm-hmm. of those, then we wouldn't be in favor of that. So, mm-hmm. for example, like fox hunting or, mm-hmm. Hunting with hounds to chase an animal down to eventually mm-hmm. kill it, we wouldn't be supportive of that. And mm-hmm. I don't think from a perspective of conservation or management, I don't think it really serves any function. Mm-hmm. You get the arguments on both sides.
Yes.
You know, the hunters will say, oh, we hardly catch any foxes, mm-hmm. but then they'll say, oh, it's necessary to control the numbers. So, you know,
yes.
which is it?
Yes.
I think in terms of angling and sort of shooting, I suppose, you know, mm-hmm. if it's I think we engage with anglers well, as you say, they report to us or to government and to different groups on like water quality. You know,
yes.
they're one of the first people to notice a downturn in fish numbers or types, or, you know, and that's very important. And, you know, they've had, you know, so there's valuable inputs there, and also probably from sort of, I suppose, field, you know, hunting or shooting, you know, if numbers this are downturn. You know, there's a funny line there, you know, if you're breeding a whole bunch of pheasants to let loose to shoot them, then that's a bit weird. But if you're, you know, if you're controlling numbers legitimately and humanely, it's all about being humane at the end of the day, then, you know, I think there's a role there perhaps.
And you know, I'm really not after going into a particular issue, right? Because I feel like on both sides there's a lot of work to do on the side of hunters and anglers, on the side of, you know, conservationists, you know, nature lovers, for want of a better term. There's a lot of work on both sides. So I don't particularly want to dive into, you know, this or other activity.
Yes.
But I'm more interested in whether Green Party recognizes those people as a stakeholders in kind of benefit in improving nature and everything else. Because this is kind of like, I speak to a lot of scientists, for example, and they said exactly what you said. Like, these hunting angling communities, they usually boots on the ground.
They are
the first to see the change. Mm-hmm. They are the first to see the change in salmon run, or water quality, or, you know, grass, or what's happening in the woods.
Yeah.
There's more birds, less birds, and so on and so forth. So what would you say to people who are hunters or anglers who are kind of, you know, saying like, oh, these are greenies, they're not really like, do you have any argument to kind of convince them that this is actually we all doing the same thing, we have the kind of same thing?
Yeah, well, I would agree with you that they are stakeholders, definitely, and you know, potentially valuable ones, because they have that connection with what they do. I mean, I'm a farmer myself, you know, and my husband's a farmer, so I think there might be a discrepancy between a sort of a rural person's view, rural green view, if you like, than maybe an urban centric view, that, you know, who might not have experienced urban life or any of those things. But I mean, you know, fishing is one of the oldest sort of things man has done. It's a bit like farming, so it's almost a relationship between farmers and the Green Party, and you know, hunters and fishermen and or anglers and the Green Party as well. There has to be a connection there. There has to be a conversation there, and there has to be respect on both sides. And I think, personally, you know, I don't really have any issue with anything, that just as long as nothing's been overly abused, or and I don't even mean an animal there, I mean just the resources or the stock or whatever, you know, as long as we don't overfish an area. You know, we're not against fishing, but we don't like overfishing. You know, we're not the least bit against farming, but we don't like, say, industrial farming where animals are all packed in indoors, for example.
Yes.
So they're those sort of, so I suppose once the happy medium is kept, then I think everyone should be able to engage and discuss.
That's a main thing, right? It's finding this happy medium and like you said, taking the view of the entire habitat of the entire population. That's a big thing, and I'm quite relieved, I must say, to hear that, because like there is a lot of people who have this opinion, like, well, okay, if Green Party has their way, you know, hunting and fishing, and it's all gone, and we all will
be forced to go vegan
and like all that.
So
that's a good moment now to move on onto farming as well. And could you tell us for our listeners now, what is view on farming? Because then again, obviously I also talk a lot of with farmers, and like, you're a farmer yourself, that this just so happens that a lot of people who are in the outdoor space, they're either farmers or they're kind of close to farmers, because obviously farmers are landowners, and if you want to do recreational stuff outdoors, you're probably running into, you know, land access issues and so on and so on. So so I've got back a little bit. So when I talk a lot of people who are also in farming, they tend to see kind of tendency of being, you know, anti-farming almost movement. And then again, I think there is a And obviously there's a lot of farmers who are supporters of Green Party, mm-hmm. but there's a lot of people who then say like, well, you know, it's everything against the farming, you know, don't do this, don't do that, and so on and mm-hmm. so on. And having said that, obviously there are unsustainable farming practices as well.
Yes.
Right? So what are the policies on the Green Party and kind of approach to farming, and how would you like this to be changed or managed?
Mm-hmm. I suppose... you know, anyone who cares to read, say, the Green Party agriculture policy, it really starts off with we're really about trying to sustain that family farming unit, you know, which is very unique to Ireland. The generational nature of farming too, you know, passing it down from, you know, parents to siblings, grandparents and further on. That again, that's quite unique in Ireland, and mm-hmm. we're very much about maintaining that. And the way we see that's best to do that is to obviously that the land is managed and farmed in a very sort of... sustainable, for want of a better word, you know, mm-hmm. but a way that's viable. And it's that three-way viability. It has to be sort of economically viable, it has to be sort of socially viable, and also environmentally viable. Mm-hmm. So if we can connect all those three and, you know, keep people on the land, keep families farming, then, you know, if we can do all of those, then, you know, we would see the sort of the future of agriculture in Ireland as being quite safe. Mm-hmm. At the moment, I mean, it's a very broad scale, but if you look at like 100 years ago in Ireland, mm-hmm. there was like 340,000 farms. You know, nowadays we've got 140,000. Now, fair enough, mm-hmm. it's plateaued off, you know, a lot. Yes. But that sort of landscape of a patchwork of farms and fields and mm-hmm. small fields, you know, that is sort of going. You know, even last year I saw, you know, hedges being removed, you know, which I considered was illegal nowadays, but it yes. isn't really. There are ways and means around it. Mm-hmm. You know, so we wouldn't like that continued expansion of farm size, you know, and if you like, mm-hmm. you know, we'd like to keep farms sort of smallish but viable, and keep it family as well, you know, keep yes. those people on the farm. But I suppose it's all about how the land, essentially, as you say, farmers are landowners. They own most of the land in Ireland, yes. probably. So it's how they manage the land is really what it comes down to. Yeah. And I think farming, the future of farming in Ireland and elsewhere, but if we just focus on Ireland, it's always going to be about food, but it's also going to be about how the land is managed and how it's used. And there are other ways and means, you know, I think.
Absolutely.
So.
Absolutely. And land management, I suppose, this is nicely connects, because the land management is, in my view at least, and that's probably I'm making that statement on the podcast, you know, 100 times already, yeah. that for habitat protection and wildlife mm-hmm. protection, land management is the key.
Yes.
Because mm-hmm. even if you want to have more animals or more diverse, you know, work on biodiversity, kind of reintroduce assemblage of the animals that used to be, so then there is also a question like, oh, but where? Right? Mm-hmm. We need to have that land.
Yes.
We need to have a land somewhere. And so do you think that Ireland needs any reform of land management, or like everything is good, or maybe there are some tweaks required?
Yeah, I think perhaps it does. I think what you've highlighted there is very important, because if we manage land for habitats and for a variety of species, if you yes. like, and a diversity of animal, then we're actually doing what's best for the environment also. You know, we're improving biodiversity, for example. We're probably improving carbon soakage, because we allow sort of rough areas to be rough, and we're not reclaiming land and draining it to make just to grow grass or something else. So I think that's important. So I think, yes, the a sort of a land use strategy or some sort of, you know, plan like that would be very interesting, and I think it would be very, very useful for our country. Now, whether it'll happen anytime soon, I doubt it, because we've such a strong, I suppose, successive governments have been so sort of strong in promoting agricultural growth, you know, really yes. at any cost, to be quite honest. You know, they'll argue that otherwise, but you know, we still have huge targets in terms of output to reach, you know, on our food policies or
yes.
food strategies. And at the same time, we're missing our targets on climate emissions and biodiversity loss. So, you know, the match is certainly not made in heaven. And until, mm-hmm. I would say, farming works with nature or with the environment, or it actually actively improves the environment, then we're on a slippery slope downwards.
And are you of the opinion that the sure way of achieving that is somehow being able to apply the value to the land or to the land used for the habitat, or, you know, to apply the value to the wildlife, whatever that value is, rather than, you know, saying like, oh, if you're going to produce this many cows or milk, this is your value, but actually you can have the same value. Or because this is not a done deal. Like a lot of successful programs around the world are based on that, right? We apply the value for the wild animals, for the habitat, and then that way they're gonna thrive.
Yeah.
But there's also a part of I suppose supporters of Green Party, or maybe ecologists more generally, saying like, well, no, it's a bad way of thinking about it. We cannot do that always this way, that we need to apply the value. Because there are certain things in life that you do, not necessarily because they're, you know, you will have benefit of it, you have a value, and we should change the way of thinking.
So yes.
This is kind of typical, which we're
I think there has to be a balance there, really. You know, you can't have all one way and not another. So I think it's about sort of getting that, I think, that, I suppose, diversity of land use. And that farming can work around it, agriculture can work around it, and also that the areas that we, you know, want, or the areas we protect can work around farming. I mean, ideally it should all happen across the same board. I mean, that's probably not going to be that, you know, but ideally we should have nice, you know, mixed swards, grasses, you know, where we've got different animals could live in them, longer grasses, you know, if we just have a, you know, at the moment, you know, farmers are encouraged to, you know, plant pretty much a single species, you know, maybe ryegrass sward, you know, maybe with some clover, and that's about as exciting as it gets, you know. Whereas there are farmers in Ireland who are embracing more of a complete diversity sort of herbal basis to their swards, and they get a much bigger, you know, much broader range of species living on their farm as a result, because there's more food and cover and all of those things. So I think there are ways and means around trying to get the best of both worlds.
And do you think there's only drivers for that are policy-based and kind of economically-based, or is it like an element of education as well?
I think education, yes, is important, and even, in fact, how education is provided. There was a recent discussion on Twitter about the new agriculture syllabus for secondary schools, you know, and there was a little bit of criticism about how it is, and it hasn't changed much, and I'm not familiar with it myself yet, so I can't really comment, but you know, how we educate the farmers of the future are important. You know, I mean, I have a degree in agriculture, and I don't recall having any, you know, modules in biodiversity or anything like that. Now that's going back a few years, you know, it's sort of 20 odd years ago, but you know, I'd like to think it's moved on, you know. So I mean, we were regular sort of conventional farmers. We had beef and sheep, suckler cows, and we converted to organic farming about 8 years ago, and it's only really now that it's really sinking in that it works, you know. We can see now that we couldn't imagine going back to conventional farming, but that's taken, you know, 6, 7, 8 years to really sink in and actively doing it. So, you know, when you look at the policies in terms of environmental schemes in this country, most of them only last about 5 years. You're sort of in and you're out, and then you're looking for the next one. You haven't actually embraced, and that for me, a policy should really be about affecting change in the direction you want, not just giving a ball of money to tick boxes and to do
but
this, that,
you
and the
need
other.
Like a continuous kind of on the governmental level, continuous commitment.
Well, you do, but I mean, you look at education in schools, you know, we don't change the syllabus every 5 years when the government goes out. You know, we sort of tend to keep the same sort of idea going, so there's no reason why they couldn't maybe do that in an agricultural policy sense.
This is, again, one of the things that I heard before, that even in the programs to encourage farmers to plant native woodlands and there is a program, and the program goes for, like you said, 5 years, 7 years, and there's something starting to happen, and then the program goes, there's no money, and the farmer goes in, cuts the woods, and puts the grass
in. That sort of type of thing, you get a little bit of that, and which is such a, you know, really, it's a waste, you know, mm-hmm. it's a waste of resources and that even that farmer's time, mm-hmm. even though he's been sort of paid for it, you would like it to last a bit longer. Or, you know, at least they see the value of it on their farm mm-hmm. and they think, well, that's good. I'm glad I planted those trees, or I'm glad I let that hedge grow, or I'm glad I reseeded that field to this type of crop.
So can you confirm or deny that there is something in works in Green Party headquarters in relation to land policy and any changes on that? Or is it like too early?
No, I think it's definitely always been, you know, it's always been sort of discussed. I mean, you mm-hmm. can probably listen back through interviews with Eamon Ryan, the party leader, and he's always spoken about a sort of land use mm-hmm. strategy and, you know, how we need to look at how we use our land. So I think it will definitely be something we will mm-hmm. we will have, you know, written up.
Mm-hmm. And you're expecting a lot of pushback from the farming community?
I think it's the way you have to sell it, and I suppose you have to be cognizant of their concerns also, mm-hmm. you know. But there are a lot of, I mean, I speak to lots of, you know, smaller farmers, like one-on-one, and they're all very much, they're not disagreeing with, you know, they're frightened in one sense, because change isn't, you know, it's not a big change. It might be radical to them, but I think, no, people don't tend to like change. But I mean, if it's done sort of gently and fair enough, and in fact makes their farms more profitable, that might be the best selling point of all, you know. Mm. And I do believe it would. I believe a green policy for agriculture would actually improve farm incomes significantly, mm-hmm. I would think, across most farms. Yeah. I would say most small farmers anyway, medium size.
And speaking about land and land use, what's the position, the Green Party position, or maybe your position, on access to land for recreational use? Because then again, one of the repeating themes, right? And this is part of why I wanted to talk to representatives of different political parties, because mm-hmm. there are certain themes in the podcast that are coming over and over, mm-hmm. and I'm very curious. Like, and so one of these themes is land access for hikers, mm-hmm. for mountain bikers. And you probably know that different counties, they have their recreational officers mm-hmm. who are working with farmers, so they tend to, you know, agree to for public access yes. to a part of land or a path or something. Mm-hmm. Like, what are the policies or plans for?
Yeah, I'm not aware that we have a specific policy for land access as such, but I do know we did last year, I think. I suppose amend part of our agricultural policy to include, we look at the sort of development of greenways, for example. I mean, mm-hmm. that's more, I suppose, you know, cycling, walking, running, whatever. Yes. But what usually happens in that is that the farmer or the landowner is one of the last people to find out about it. You know, they just get told, oh, by the way, we're going to put a greenway through your farm. Okay. Whereas we our policy on that, or our motion on that, was to farmers need to be brought in at the initial stage of that, and they can actually help, maybe, you know, yes. help with the process, but that the farmers should be first. Mm-hmm. And that was actually brought in by a colleague of mine, Roisin Garvey in County Clare. She was mm-hmm. recently elected also, but I mean, very much a sort of hands-on, like, let's get the farmers involved in yeah. doing that, instead of just sort of telling them at the end, because nobody really likes being told, by yeah, the way.
Especially if it's like, it's my land.
Yes, exactly. You know, and in the policy also is to support farmers, that if they need further payments, or, you know, for fencing the area, that they're mm-hmm. supported in that. They're not just expected to do it, you know, or mm-hmm. so I think there's good ways and bad ways of doing mm-hmm. that sort of thing. In terms of actual access onto land for, you know, across fields, and that, I'm not sure. I mean, we're farm owners ourselves, and we're mm-hmm. we don't actually get that many where we are, you know, we're sort yeah. of off the beaten track a bit, but I know there's huge issues with sort of insurance, and that seems to be the problem. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, we don't ban people from our farm, but we just don't see anyone really out on it either, you know?
but that's my, you're actually nicely moved on to my next point, because this is what I heard, that the way the law is structured, that's the big problem, because mm-hmm. farmers are, you know, they're afraid to be liable. That someone comes in, breaks a leg, and is like, oh, I'm going to sue you.
Yes.
Because you're like, hey, I didn't invite you. Mm-hmm. And that creates a tension.
Yes. Right? So I think maybe the legislation should be maybe tidied up on that, that, you know, mm-hmm. people accept their own responsibility if, you know, that it's not... I mean, people might go onto somebody's land, as you say, uninvited or trespassing, if you want to use the strong mm-hmm. word, and mm-hmm. injure themselves, and still the landowner is liable. So it yeah. seems a bit messy, all right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And is there something that you guys have in plans for that?
Not yet, as far as I know, but I mean, I'm sure it's definitely something we could explore. Yeah.
Oh, it just the green wave just happened, so this is yes. probably one of the things that you will need to think.
Well, that's it, I think, in terms of you know, because it's always good to have people outdoors. We're very much yes. in favor of that, and getting people, you know, there's a whole, you know, it's array of information
podcast.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, but even, you know, for good mental health, there's mm-hmm. data there suggesting, you know, exercising in green spaces yeah. or literally, you know, walking yeah. outdoors is much better than in a gym.
I had at least like a two podcast where we were talking about the benefits for mental health.
Yeah, I think it's pretty significant.
Of the outdoors. I'm just going to touch on one more thing with relation to farming, and this is, we're going to move on then. So that one last thing is, you mentioned earlier that you're really not that much in favor of kind of connecting the farms and making like a big farms
mm-hmm.
more. And so does this not make the making any policies or any changes, whether with regards to change of access and law, or whether it's with relation to, you know, habitat protection or rewilding or whatever else, so much more difficult if you have these very small, you know, farms, and one farmer here, one farmer there, you have so many stakeholders to, you know, work with. So I almost, like, in my head, it's like, well, it would be much easier to have a, like, a, almost like a rancher types.
Yes.
Folks who owns and what I'm
thousands
saying,
of hectares.
Yes. Because, you know, and what I'm saying is a very successful conservation program in Argentina. I think it's in Argentina. I mean, in South America, anyway.
Yes.
Where non-governmental organization, they can buy a land from a rancher, and because those ranchers are so big, it's such a, even one purchase is such a big impact on the habitat and everything,
mm-hmm.
because it's so vast
yes.
amount of land. So now when you said, like, oh, you know, we kind of promoting and supporting these local farmers,
mm-hmm.
family, little, then that probably will make that task so much more difficult because you have so many stakeholders.
Well, possibly, but again, I think that could be legislated for, that, you know, they're all either, you know, that they're protected, you know, that mm-hmm. it's not, you don't, that an individual or a group wouldn't have to necessarily, I mean, fair enough, they might contact, you know, 10 landowners mm-hmm. and saying, can we hike across your farm, for example, but I think if the legislation were in place to provide ample protection for those landowners, they would be less inclined to say no. So
yeah.
I think, you know, I think, you know, from a biodiversity perspective, mm-hmm. I think we would be more inclined to see sort of smaller farms, you know, because you're mm-hmm. more likely to have you don't have one farm with just one big field. Even a small farm might have 10 fields.
There's more opportunity.
I think so, yeah. I think, and it might actually make for more interesting mm-hmm. explorations, you
yeah.
know, for
yeah.
outdoorsy types, you know,
yes.
rather than just, you know, you think of a big field and it's just got a boundary around the edge
yeah.
and not
yeah.
much in the middle.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean,
so
like
that tends to what happens
mm-hmm.
when farms get bigger. They make their fields
yeah,
tend to have
good,
bigger, you
that's
know.
That's a
so,
good point, because so, actually what I had in my mind is like not necessarily one big field, but like one owner of a
yes
land.
Yeah, well, that's a yeah
but
different way yes
now
mm-hmm.
is like yeah, but then what tends to happen, they
yeah.
will take down the hedges, they will kind of, you
yeah.
know, remove all the things that are separating those fields and make it one
a little bit
field.
Yeah, because if they're going to be big, they
mm-hmm.
need to have big machinery, and they need to
okay.
be cost effective in terms of how
okay.
they manage the land. So that's where
and
it comes down to,
and this is what the policy of growth and bigger
in a way yes
drives.
Yeah, it drives that, because it drives a sector that needs to keep producing, because when you look at Ireland, it really punches above its weight in terms of, say, beef and dairy output.
Yes.
You know, we produce enough to feed something like 50 million people. You know,
yes.
there's only four or five here, but
yeah.
We're competing on a global scale at that. You know, we're competing against huge like South American beef, and we're competing against New Zealand milk. And if we're going to be competing on a price, we're, you know, you're going to run out of space soon. You know, what happens when the price drops? You know, this would be a concern as well for the sort of integrity and the viability of farms if they continue to go that sort
because
of route.
Then you're slipping quickly into the model of subsidies.
Well, that's it. I mean, we are sort of there a bit anyway, but I mean, you can't rely on that forever either, you know.
Yes. Absolutely. Biodiversity. We already touched on biodiversity. Yeah. Can you lay it out for our listeners from the perspective of Green Party and where you're sitting? How what is the history in Ireland of the loss of the biodiversity? Why we in the situation we are now, and what are the plans to fix that? Since obviously you're coming to and kind of having more and more power, and I believe you hope that the coming elections will be as successful.
Well, I think Ireland is no different to a lot of countries either in terms of biodiversity loss. I mean, even in my childhood, you know, 30 years ago, say, I can remember things that were, I'm from County Mayo originally, but I remember different, you know, we could see newts or big dragonflies, you know, lots of primroses, for example. You know, curlews, we had lots of curlews in Mayo when I was a kid, you know, and they're just not there anymore, really, you know, and
critically endangered.
Absolutely, you know, so, I mean, that's a very iconic bird, and it's on our coins, or used to be, you know, and this sort of thing, but, you know, those sort of very obvious ones, and the corncrake, I mean, I speak to older people who have heard corncrakes, you know, I've never heard one, you know, but, you know, those very obvious things that have, you know, clearly declined. I think I mean, you hear figures on our insect numbers, I mean, that whole windscreen phenomenon, you know, we very, you know, cognizant as a kid of those, you know, bugs all mashed on our windscreen at night and, you know, and hitting it. But now you really don't get that anymore. That's quite a very striking thing, you know. And if you've no less insects, then there's less food
for
the next stage. Yeah, but it is quite scary. And I think biodiversity loss is very tangible to people, you know, because they can talk to someone who remembers seeing that or there's less of that. I mean, even swallows this year seem a little bit less... I don't know, maybe it's our rubbish summer, you know, but
do
you know,
think
comments...
it's kind of driven through the policies, like some lack of policies in place?
I think it ultimately must be, because, I mean, they do tend to, I mean, I know there's other industrial problems as well, but they do tend to point the finger a lot at agriculture for those particular losses. I suppose if they are the main landowners and biodiversity needs the land, you know, we don't have too much biodiversity in our cities, for example, so we do need rural countryside areas. And I think the hedge losses has been huge over the last, say, 100 or 150 years. I think it's been quite significant. And there's that general... apathy to it. I think it's not as much now, but, you know, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, people wouldn't really have thought twice about biodiversity. I mean, it was hardly a word that was commonly spoken of. I mean, most people wouldn't know what it meant, you know, but now we hear it all the time, every day. So, but, you know, I think definitely policies that have been in place, maybe not directly set out to destroy biodiversity, but it's indirectly has caused that. Yeah, and I think that if you want to improve biodiversity, then you need to put the policies in that do that.
So what are the policies that you have in kind of in works, or
again, you're looking at aspects of, like, what does biodiversity mean and what does it need, you know? So if we're looking at, you know, if it's birds and bees and insects and that, we need to provide them with the food and the home and the shelter to do that. So again, you're looking at sort of planting a variety of plants, I suppose. You're looking at maybe looking at a shift away from sort of chemical inputs into our lands, you know, like pesticides as well. I mean, you know, there is the argument, oh yeah, Roundup doesn't kill bees, but it kills the things that bees need to eat, you know, or need the food to, you know, and that's the point.
Yeah, and that's a good point. And again, this goes a lot of to education, because even if you see, like, on the estates, right, there's a green area, and then there's a, you know, a lot of money goes into pay the guy who goes in and sprays poison onto that green area.
Yes,
it's like, hey, why are we doing this, actually? Yeah. So that probably also goes to education of people and saying, like, well, maybe... That's not a good idea.
I think that, and you see even the way the towns sort of set up as developed, you know, 20 years ago, tidy towns was about that. It was spraying every weed and cutting the grass to an inch high and everything neat and tidy. And now the tidy town sort of movement has shifted towards sort of pollinator biodiversity friendly. So you have sort of rather more untidy, doing the finger thing there, untidy places winning awards because they're being judged on a different you know, on a different scale now, so they're being judged for their pollinator friendly plants and their overgrown areas.
And that's, so surely that's something which you would count as that green wave.
I think so. That would have helped. Yes, I think so. And I think at the end of the day, farmers and landowners have the biggest, the largest way of improving that. You know, they have that they have the land, and the land is what we need.
Do you think that what happened that the penny dropped? What was that? Is that the changes become so obvious that people start to notice them, or is it were because of you know, few people who are, you know, desperately so screaming about those issues and they finally?
Are you talking about the green wave or just
like in the terms, like you said, like, you know, nobody was really talking about biodiversity. Nobody was really talking about the pollinator grass. And now,
I think it's probably a mixture of a few things. I think the whole, people tend to talk like, let's talk about climate change, or let's talk about biodiversity, or let's talk about this, you know, or soils, or let's talk about farming. They tend to talk about these pockets of things, you know, instead of the lot of them really need to be spoken about in one sort of conversation because they all affect each other. But I think in terms of people's views, I think, there's been a lot of coverage over sort of plastics and waste in the last, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 years, you know, expensive TV documentaries on it. I think biodiversity loss is, again, it's been brought to the fore. The whole climate change aspect is big as well. So I think there's been a lot of major sort of coverage, if you like, media coverage, and people are just so much more aware, I think, of those issues. And if you want to deal with any of those issues, you really have to follow a greener policies, definitely.
That's so now we get to the big one, which is climate change, right? You mentioned that. How that situation look like in your view, or in the view of Green Party?
The world or in Ireland, or
well, you want to start tackling that, it's so big.
I think anyone who's fully sort of embraces the whole problem sees it is a huge problem, you know. I mean, countries like, you know, Ireland and, you know, developed countries are probably relatively, you know, climate proof because we have wealth and we don't live in low-lying coastal regions. We don't live in particularly stormy areas, you know. But I mean, if you live,
well, I don't know about that.
Well, I know that's true. Yeah, we had our fair share, I suppose. Yeah, over the last number of years. But you know, but I mean, it's a huge tragedy for our planet, I think, and it's going to be a huge human tragedy. You know, if you live in somewhere like Bangladesh or somewhere, you know, you're doomed, really, you know. And there's a lot of people, poor people, who are cannot remove themselves from maybe where they live, don't have the wealth to avoid it. And I think there's definitely, you know, it's all great Donald Trump, you know, saying I'm coming out of the Paris agreement and I'm going to do my own thing. But I mean, that guy's a billionaire. He's never going to be affected by climate change, you know. And I think there's a lot of people who are, you know, I don't know what the figure would be, but I'm sure there's some sort of materialistic figure there that you're going to be safe whatever happens because you've got the money and you've got the means and you can move. But if you're below that level, you know, and that's worth, you know, sharing with people that it's not, you know, I mean, we have to deal with it ourselves in terms of, you know, there are changes in our climate and the temperature changes and extremes of weather, and even outdoor people and farmers are going to have to adapt to that, but then we also have the obligation to mitigate it and
when the farmers get hit, then, you know, like them being, especially in Ireland, them being such a huge part of the economy, then it will affect economy.
Well, that's true, and it costs us then if we have to, support farmers or support people who have been affected.
So what Green Party wants to do about the climate change and meeting our emission
Well,
do you think this is that this makes sense to meet those emission goals?
Well, because I think
there are,
so.
There are people who are saying like, yeah, that's all wrong altogether as well.
Yeah. Well, listen, we've signed up to the agreements with the Paris Agreement, where we're obliged to, or we've been asked to meet targets which we're missing. You know, we're going to miss 2020's one already, and it's going to cost us a couple of million euros worth of fines, a couple of hundred million, sorry. And that's going to, I think that's set to rise over the next 10 years if we don't, in parallel with how far away we are from our targets. So so it's going to cost Irish taxpayers money if we don't actually do anything about it, And there's three sectors, really. You've got your transport sector, you've your energy sector, and you've your agriculture. They're the three main sort of emitters in Ireland, and each one has a role to play and a duty of care to us as its citizens to play that role. So in a way, agriculture does get the thick end of the wedge in terms of criticism about it.
That's interesting, because on one end we already mentioned that the farming is a way to actually address the problem. On the other hand, like, oh, but you are the problem.
Farming is part of the problem, but I think it could well have the best opportunity to
be a solution,
When you look at the other sectors, energy, we are trying to decarbonize our energy sector, move away from fossil fuels, increase renewables. But again, that's a sort of slow burner, pardon the pun, because people are reluctant, and even the government's sort of reluctant. We were the first country to divest our public funding of fossil fuel companies, but yet we're still allowing offshore drilling. So it's it's steeped with sort of hypocrisy. Transport, again, we're meant to be decarbonizing our transport sector, and yet where you've got I live in County Offaly, and if I'm going to Dublin, I tend to go on the M7, and they're widening that for more cars, so it's all very, and then agriculture, we're still pursuing an increased production model, which is completely, correlated with increasing our emissions. So you really have to ask the questions about from the policymakers, like, what are you doing?
Interesting. And on the energy sector, what's your view on renewables? Because there is a lot of like, oh, we need to move out from fossil fuels, we need to move to renewables. And I personally, I don't see what renewables, because obviously, well, wind farms, right? Wind farms, they're not exactly beautiful on the landscape.
Well, I personally don't mind them. I think
you don't mind
them. I don't mind them. No, I think they're... I don't mind the turbines themselves. I actually, every week, I organise a park run in Mount Lucas Wind Farm in County Offaly. I think it's the biggest sort of, it's a one you can actually go on to. Most of them are closed, so you can actually run around it. It's a great amenity. It's safe. Mm-hmm. It's off-road. Kids are safe on it, and you can sort of almost get up close and personal to a wind turbine.
But it would be sad if we have every single mountain in Ireland littered with...
True, and I don't think that will happen, because, I think the developments will tend to go more offshore from now on, where you've got a more consistent wind flow. But in terms of renewable, I think most your average biggish turbine, I don't have the figures, but I think after the energy that's used to create a turbine is paid in the lifetime of the turbine is 25 to 30 times repaid, so it's really a no-brainer, even if you only it produces far more than it costs to put up. And it's wind is one of the best renewable sources, because
Germany failed with their program.
Well, they didn't. I mean, a lot of the ones I think in Germany and on the continent, they looked at more from a community owned scheme. Mm-hmm. So the local community gained from having, say, a wind farm around them. Yeah. They all bought into it.
In general, as a country, right? They have the highest price of energy of the European countries, right? Mm-hmm. And they end up kind of refurbishing and starting the old coal plants that they already retired, because they just weren't able to provide so much
energy. Maybe they weren't set up well enough to do that. And I know they want to move away from their coal, and they're not doing the nuclear thing, so they're moving away from that. So it's, they're going to have to get their energy from somewhere, I mean, there's potential in solar panels as well. I mean, I think, at the end of the day, the fossil fuels will run out eventually if we keep mining them. So then what? So we need to leave those where they are, because every time we burn a lump of coal or a bit of turf or whatever, we are releasing things, and we need to keep that in our planet, you know, or in our ground. That's the big thing as well.
To put all the carbon back into the atmosphere.
Yeah, no, because we'll have to try and get it back out there somehow.
But what's your view on nuclear? Because it seems like there's more and more people saying, like, well, that's the way, that's the only way we can actually power, you know, in a green way, the humanity, for the right, speaking in general, because like wind turbines, like there are issues with wind turbines, right? They're not all the people like them on the landscape. Migratory birds are getting, you know, minced in those and so on and so forth. Solar is like total,
works during the day.
But from the nature and from the wildlife perspective, it's a total disaster, right? We have a lot of talk, and this is another thing that I want to touch with you about the forestry, right? There's a lot of like, oh, we're doing all this at Gasprost, it's a disaster, it pollutes the waters, and it's like really timber factory rather than any sort of. But at least it's green, right? Mm-hmm. Now imagine the same land being cleared to put the solar panels.
Well, they can put solar panels on grass, and you can graze sheep under them. You know, you can
under them.
Yeah, they can, and you don't lose. Actually, as far as I know, they were trying to. I'm not sure what the policy per se is on it, but I think it's still classified as agricultural land. That's a bit of a problem with farmers if they allow solar panels on their land. Uh-huh. Is the land still classified as agricultural land? You know, and I think if it is, then you know. But that's besides the point. But yeah, you can graze sheep under solar panels, so it's actually a double. So it is quite green, very green.
That's
so they're, you know, they're slight. They're not quite on the. They're raised somewhat, you know. And then you've got all these roofs, you know, especially, you know, farmers have lots of sheds, and even new build buildings, you could stick them on top of this. So there's a lot of potential there, and I think the price of the cells themselves are coming right down, you know, so it's not as expensive.
So going back for a second, so what's the deal with nuclear? Are you guys are for
we are sort of, I think on the whole, we're probably, you know, we would have campaigned against nuclear because that was, we saw the you know, if anything went wrong, it was a serious problem, you know, and we've still got, you know, you read things about Chernobyl and nuclear disasters have been catastrophic for those areas, environmentally as well, and for the people, you know.
It turns out that they weren't. I think that this is the strongest argument for a lot of people on the green side now campaigning for nuclear energy, that after these many years, it turns out that the issues were not nearly as bad. Like, and the Chernobyl is one of the examples that this was like as bad as the disaster as it could be, because there was like literally running reactor without any, you know, and the predictions were about, you know, cancer and this and that and something else, and none of that actually materialized. There was a big problem.
Well,
at
I
the
don't
moment.
Know. There, I
but
know
in
people,
general, it turns out to be not that bad, and that's. As far as I'm concerned, it's one of the key arguments of people that are kind of coming back. It's like, hey, that's actually cheap, relatively clean. You can produce a lot of energy, and you don't need vast amounts of land to produce that energy, because that's a really biggest problem with wind and solar. You need a vast amount of land, but then it's not wildlife, it's not anything, well, maybe farmland.
Yeah. I suppose the main concerns with it are, as I said, if there were a spillage or a leakage or an explosion or a disaster there, and also, you know, the waste to deal with, and you know, and I suppose if all those boxes are checked and we know it's perfectly safe and there's not going to be any leakage or any emissions from it, then, you know, it definitely has to be considered, because if we run out of other options, I think we're still, you know, we need more sort of scientific sort of proof as to its, you know, its safety. Really, it comes down to the safety at the end of the day, I think.
On the waste, this is an interesting thing, because waste, like nuclear energy produces the smallest amounts of waste, because it turns out that after like 10 years or 20 years of producing energy, you can store all the waste from the nuclear energy in one room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's it. You're not...
But it's still nasty waste, you know, and there's waste, not ash out of a fire either, you know. Yeah, I know, but little but potent, you know, if it gets out into the environment. I think that's, you know, maybe we blast it all into space, I don't know.
Ah, yeah. Google space. Like, let's explore all our problems.
Outer space. Yeah.
Outer space. Yes, very good. So in now coming back a little bit. So on the climate change, what are the plans for tackling climate change? Like you know, solid actions that you guys have in store.
Well, I mean, I suppose decarbonizing our whole economy, but I suppose in terms of the energy, yes, it'd be having to, you know, adapt more renewable energies. Transport, definitely looking at more sort of public transport systems, where we're not reliant on cars. You know, obviously we need to support maybe electric vehicles, the development of that. I think that's particularly important for rural areas. I mean, yeah. Everyone thinks, oh, they won't last the distance, but they're fine. I know several people with electric vehicles living close to me, and they love them. It's the best thing they ever bought.
Yeah.
You know, so that range anxiety people talk about isn't an issue. You know, because, I mean, if you are in rural Ireland, you can't have a bus going up and down every little highway and byway. You know, you will need your own. But in urban areas, definitely, they should be adopting more. I mean, I think there's great examples around Europe, and you just need to look at the best ones there and bring them on board. But I think, you know, I mean, we were talking about cycling earlier on in rural roads. My goodness, I would be terrified to cycle in Dublin. You know, you have a cycle lane, then it just sort of disappears, you know, and there's a bus about, you know, 6 inches from, you know.
I remember 2 years when I 2 years ago, when I get to Dublin and we just driving now to Dublin and we see all those cyclists and we just all passionate cyclists and we love cycling and we look at those cyclists and we're like, this is not good.
No. You know, and there have been deaths, and I know I'm sure they happen everywhere, but I mean, it's really not a city set out for cyclists, you know. It's the city. I mean, I was there yesterday in Dublin, not there very often. I had to drive because I was going to a part that wasn't really accessible, and I had to get back to Eden Derry for my first meeting. But even for driving, it was horrific. Transport in Dublin is a nightmare, unless you're just using the Lewis or something like that. But
actually,
to drive,
driving is like in every city.
Cars shouldn't be in cities. You know, isn't that the whole point? It's not really designed for them.
More and more cities are moving that way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would that be something that you propose to get rid of cars from the city centres?
Well, I think so. But you can't just get rid of cars without putting something in place for people to use. You know, I mean, you look at even all the car parks in Dublin city centre; they're packed. You know, and I'm sure those guys, they want to keep the cars common because there's a nice, you know, income to be made of having a green
green grass there.
But I think, yeah, perhaps. But I think definitely, I think a move towards, public transport in cities will have to be addressed, you know. And, you know, I live quite close to a train station in Port Arlington, which is really well servicing Dublin, you know. So you can live that far away and still be in Dublin in 45 minutes to an hour, you know. So it's...
And then if you can in Dublin have like an efficient way of transport, then...
Well, that's it, you know. So there's a lot of people who do commute, you know, but I don't think it's rocket science, any of these things, but it needs that political will. It needs
people
to... You know
what I'm most concerned about when we talk, like in general, people, not we, but in general, we as general talk about transport? Elderly folks. This is like elderly folks seems to be kind of left behind always, you know, whether it comes to technology.
It's true.
And there's a lot of elderly people who are driving their, you know, or old Ford or Toyota. And now all of a sudden, like, well, no, you can't. Go cycle.
Well,
right?
I know, yes, yeah. You have to be reasonable and you have to be, you know, so practical about it and accommodate, you know, whether, you know, you have a phased in something or other, gives people a chance, or maybe certain sectors you don't ever ask to change, you know, because it's beyond
It's like how much of that is happening.
Yeah, but I suppose the vast majority of people moving every day are in the workforce. They're going to and from a job, I'm imagining. So I think, you know, they're the people you really need to be.
That's the way forward. Mm-hmm. And do you think, like, what do you think, even personally, what's the time frame that we can do anything about it? Or do you think that the situation is so dire?
No, I think you can't give up and you have to keep trying. But I think, I mean, time frame in terms of, you know, big fines or you know, having to buy, you know, carbon credits. I mean, they're talking of figures for 2030 in just like 10 years time of like 6 billion. I mean, that's... That build 3 children's hospitals, you know, that's so the cost of not actually doing this, it's going to be expensive, all right, to achieve all of these, carbon savings in all sectors. But the cost of not doing it is going to be, you know, financially and then actually environmentally and your future of your country. I mean, you actually rule out people investing in Ireland if we're not meeting targets, because they're saying, well, I'm not going to invest in a country that's not actually making any effort or good enough effort to do that, because it's going to cost me to maybe operate there. You know, I'll find the pro...
Yes, because you're going to be looking for money somewhere.
Exactly, maybe I'll scan across and find the proactive, you know, maybe Scandinavian countries or something like that. Maybe I'll invest there because they're perhaps making more of a more of a effort.
There's a lot of kind of worry that all those measures, all those, you know, carbon reduction measures are going to hit the poorest people the most, right? What do you say, like, how do you plan to, because surely you thought about this and have some plans.
Well,
because even you mentioned, right, like the people who are wealthy, they're just whatever.
Exactly, yeah.
And then, and that goes from a scale, like a locally in Ireland, but also like a globally,
absolutely,
right? Like, you know, all the developing countries in Africa, well, now you can't have all your energy. It's like, hey, you've been benefiting from the energy and all this pollution for like 100 years, and now we want that and we can't have it.
Yes,
right? And this is kind of this mechanism.
I suppose in Ireland, we've proposed a sort of a tax dividend, a carbon dividend, where you would pay everyone out a certain proportion, which will help them towards their costs, you know, so if you want to spend it on more carbon friendly, you know, fuel or whatever, then that's better. We've tried to address that sort of distinction between sort of, you know, poorer people who might be able to afford.
So you're talking about this fear of the carbon tax.
I suppose, a little bit that. But, you know, you have to bring everyone along with you. You can't just protect one sector ahead of another. And, you know, I think the Greens are quite strong on that, you know, on being sort of fair across the board. Very much so, you know. So, you know.
So fair, also scale that to capacity.
Well, that's it, you know, because if you don't have
because if you slab like 20% of everybody, then it's
That's true. Or you will have to angle it so you've supported the ones who cannot afford it. Because I mean, if you're putting out grants to, you know, retrofit your home and make it super insulated, if you just can't afford to do that or access the grant, you know, it's unfair to challenge those people or tax them or whatever to the same level. It's just not fair. So we need to, that needs a lot of consideration, you know.
Okay.
We definitely,
So but we're like very, just
no, I don't know, not everyone, okay. No, because we need to be very cognizant of that. And as I said, be fair and bring everyone on this green wave.
Yeah, very good. So last question. Last question. Forestry.
Oh yes.
So, what you're planning? What are you guys planning to do with forestry and all this timber factories?
Yes. I suppose our vision for forestry in Ireland, again, it would probably fit in with our vision for land use as well. You know, but we feel very strongly that we should be following a sort of a continuous cover model of forestry. You know, no clear cuts, because I think they're just pretty much a disaster for everything. You know, bar the lumber merchant who, you know, but that's fair enough. You can still get timber out of continuous cover. It'll take a bit longer from like zero to when it's ready, but when it is productive, maybe in 50, 60, 70 year, 80 years time, you're getting a constant, you know, flow from it. I mean, I visited a family in Cologne the last two summers. My children have spent a couple of weeks there, just learning a bit of German and stuff. And it's near a town near Cologne, but they live in a forest. It's their forest. It's a continuous cover forest. And it has a mixture of spruce and it has some broadleaf and a variety of everything. But it's a continuous cover model. So they just take, you know, certain percentage out every year. It self-seeds. So you see different ages. You know, I think the forest itself is maybe in around 100 years old. So there's very much quite mature trees. And then there's the whole way along. Now it's 110 hectares. It's a big area. You know, for Ireland that'd be a huge area of forestry, but you know, on a farm. But it's a viable income. They live off it, and it's, you know, they don't have to clear fell it, and there's wild boar there, and there's deer, and there's a variety of wildlife.
But I suppose
wildlife.
The problem is that what we have is it's so dense. There's no wildlife there.
Yeah, that's because it's grown purely as a commercial entity to be clear felled in 25, 30 years' time.
So what you're saying is, if we address the problem of clear felling, then there's no no reason to plant those trees in that way.
Yes, I think not. I think be slightly. I think I, you know, forests were naturally seeded themselves. You know, over the hundreds of thousands of years. You know, they weren't all planted. You know, they just happened, and that was the diversity you got. And you got the great big oaks and the great, you know, diversity of trees there. So I think a shift towards that sort of a model of forestry, also agroforestry, which is where you plant trees in fields, you know, quite well spaced out, but you can graze animals through that. And as those trees grow up and they provide shelter, they stabilize the soil, they help retain moisture, it's, you know, it's a flood defense as well. But again, that needs policy to support it. I mean, there are supports for that, but again, I think they should be a longer term, you know, for the lifetime of the, you
and
know,
these are the policies that you guys
would, those sort of things we'd be forward. Very much pushing for. Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic. And to move
it's
away.
Fantastic. I know that you're stuck on time. So is there any concluding thought, anything that you wish we spoke about, talk about, or maybe just a, you know, concluding thought on for our listeners?
I think we've covered a fair range of subjects there. You threw a few at me. I wasn't expecting some of the questions, but no, it's good to talk. And no, it's been very enjoyable. And thank you very much for the questions. And yeah, just looking forward to my own, you know, my own political career. You know, I'm a councillor now and see what I can achieve at a local level. I'd love to, you know, apply a lot of these, you know, biodiversity, pollinators, through the council. You know, councils have roles to play in this too. Yeah. So I definitely will follow that up and see how well I get on.
You'll do well, I'm
sure. I hope so.
I wish you good luck.
Thank
good
you very
job.
Much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.